Good evening. It's good to see everybody who's out with us this evening, this rainy day. It's just been an amazing turn of events throughout the week as far as the weather goes, but we'll continue on no matter whatever the weather holds for us. If you'd like to turn your Bibles to James in chapter 5, we'll continue our study through the book of James. And as in the past couple weeks, we've had three different lessons that we're going to find from the book of James. And when we consider the end of the book of James, there are three individuals that are mentioned. And what we're going to do is we're going to spend time this afternoon, this evening, looking at these three different individuals. We're going to look at the Lord of Sabaoth, we're going to look at Job, and then we're going to look at Elijah. When we see James drawing this to a close, he really started last week, we looked at James 4, and really started hitting the nail on the head. The things that he was really going to talk about with partiality and how we treat one another and living by faith and these ideas, he really comes to fruition in chapter 5. And the people that I mentioned and that he mentions in verses 4, 11, and 17 really draw examples and gives us something to watch out for and to look at. And it highlights really the passages. So let's go ahead and start. Well, we'll start reading in James chapter 1. We're going to start looking chapter 5, starting in verse 1, and we're going to look to verse 6, and we're going to come across the Lord of Sabaoth. Let's read it together. It says, "Come now, you rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver are corroded, and their corrosion will be a witness against you, and will eat your flesh like fire. You have heaped up treasure in the last days. Indeed, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, cry out. And the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth. You have lived on the earth in pleasure and luxury. You have fattened your hearts as in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the just. He does not resist you." Now, when we look at this word, Lord of Sabaoth, what it's talking about is the Lord of hosts. The Lord of hosts. It's talking about God. Now, when we look at this idea, what James is telling them is that God has heard the prayers of those who's been crying out. And God sees exactly what is going on. See, it's important for us to remember that in our lives. There are times we may get to a point where we say, well, God doesn't care and God's not watching and God's not looking over this situation, but that's not true. God sees each and every situation and hears all the prayers that are lifted up. Let's go ahead and look a little bit at some things that God knows, the Lord of Sabaoth sees. If we turn our Bibles over to 1 Timothy in chapter 5, Paul is instructing the young preacher here in matters of the congregation, matters of setting things up, and what he's wanting them, what he's wanting Timothy to do is he's wanting him to be careful. Be careful of who he lays hands on or who he aligns himself with, who it is that he is going to put into a position where they can have a big part in the congregation. And notice what happens in verse 24. He says, "Some men's sins are clearly evident, preceding them to judgment, but those of some men follow later. Likewise, the good works of some are clearly evident, and those that are otherwise cannot be hidden." And when we look here in verse 24, notice what Paul said. He said, some sins of men are clearly seen. There are things, you know, we see certain individuals, and we look at them and we say, they've really messed up. Or we look at them and say, that's not the way we're supposed to behave. And, you know, just to give, for instance, when we look back in on Wednesday night's lesson, with the woman that came and was crying over Jesus' feet and wiping his feet with her hair and anointing his feet with fragrant oil, what was it that Simon the Pharisee knew about that lady? He knew her as a sinful individual because of her life. She was known to be that way. And so there are some people, we look at them, we say, there's something with their life. They have to get straightened out. But did you notice what else he says? But those of some men follow later. You know, there are some things, some people, they do things that we don't always know what they're up to. We don't always know how they act and behave. So they act and behave one way when they're with us, and we think things are going the right way. But there's another action they're completing over here that we don't know anything about. But they're acting in that way. But you know who sees that? We may never know. But God knows that. God knows that. And that was part of that warning when we look back in verse 22. Do not lay hands on anyone hastily, nor share in other people's sins. Keep yourself pure. The idea is there are some things we see as sinful, and it's way out in the front. We can spot it. But there are some people who can kind of fool us for a little while. But there's one person they're not going to fool. See, the Hebrews writer does exactly the same thing in Hebrews in chapter 4. When we start reading verse 12 and 13. 13 is where I want to look at. But if we go up to verse 12, notice how the Hebrews writer leads into this discussion. He says, "For the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the vision of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Now, if we just stop there and looked at that just for a second, what the Hebrews writer is doing is he's saying the word of God can cut directly to the heart of the matter. The word of God gets to what is really going on. When we start looking into God's word, we realize there are things we're doing all right in and doing well, and we realize there are things we need to change in our lives. Even if 100 people told us we needed to change this, God's word is the one that says, you got to change it. And we read it different. We'll listen to God's word before we may even listen to our best friends. We ought to. But notice what it says in verse 13. "And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account." Now notice the idea. There's nothing that is hidden from God's sight. There's nothing that can be covered up in front of God. God sees everything. Everything. There's nothing we can hide. So if you will, we cannot color our hair enough for God to say, "I don't know what color your hair is." We can change our clothes from daylight to dark and he'll still know exactly who we are. We can lose 50 or 60 pounds and we look just the same to God. He's seen all of that. See, that's the thing we talk about God. God knows. There's no tricking God. So it's like if we get back and we know this past week we haven't done what we're supposed to do, and there's no going back and say, "Well, God, I tried my best." If we didn't, have you ever thought about that? The whole idea is if we didn't try our best and we feel guilty because we listened to a Sunday morning sermon and we really didn't try our best, God already knows we didn't try our best. He knows that. That's not a secret to him. So when we go back to James 5, notice a lot of people just focus on the first two verses or three verses, and they act like the having of money, it was the problem. But it wasn't the having of money. That wasn't the problem. The problem was how they got their money. Notice what it said in verse 4. "Indeed, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, you kept back by fraud. Cry out, and the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth. You have lived on the earth in pleasure and luxury. You have fattened your hearts as in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the just. He does not resist you." They were using their brethren and not paying them, although they said they would. They were abusing that relationship in Christ. They withheld wages that was due to that individual. They didn't pay them. So why is it that their riches are corrupted? It's not because they had money. It's because they kept money away from those they owed money. See, that was the problem. And you know who saw it? And it wasn't just a people who were defrauded. It wasn't just a people who were wanting their paycheck, so to speak. The Lord heard that very cry, and he knows. He knew the situation at hand. It's not hidden from him. He knows. He knows. So when we look at this idea, we have to remember that we are going to have to give an account for our actions one day. We're going to have to give an account for our lives one day. See, we're going to turn our Bibles over to 2 Corinthians in chapter 5 and verse 9. Notice what Paul says to them. He says, therefore we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to him. And what Paul is telling the individuals here in Corinthians, in Corinth, is that whether he was with them or somewhere else, he wanted to live his life to be well-pleasing to God. It didn't matter where he was. But notice what he says in verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known in your consciences. Now, notice what Paul said there. Paul said everybody is going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ. That everybody also included the Apostle Paul. He didn't get a free pass because he was the Apostle Paul. He didn't get a free pass because he was preaching the gospel to people. He didn't get a free pass because he was taking up a collection for poor saints. He didn't get a free pass because he was somebody on God's side and God heard his voice and answered prayers and heard the singing. He didn't get a free pass from any of that. When the judgment comes, Paul still has to give an account for what he has done. We're the same way. We're the same way. See, God sees our lives. There's nothing hidden to him. And it's important to notice those things. It's important to notice those things. God sees. God sees. Now let's go back to James 5. Now you read, like it says, we read through here, they've kept back, they have done wrong, they have wronged their brethren, they have really mistreated them. But notice what he says. Now the gear is shifted, so to speak. Notice what he says in verse 7. Therefore be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and latter rain. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. My brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord as an example of suffering and patience. Indeed, we count them blessed who endure. You have heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end intended by the Lord, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. Now let's stop here for a second. Now notice we have this concept of Job and Job's perseverance. He's mentioned here as an example of what it means to persevere and continue on through all this hardship and suffering. So let's go look at him just for a few minutes. So just turn your Bibles back to Job in chapter 1. There's something we don't often think about when we consider Job and his suffering. See, when we look at Job was an upright and blameless man. Now, imagine this. We have God saying that Job was blameless and upright, one who feared God and shunned evil. Now, if you want somebody to write something about you, would you not want God to write that about you? I mean, that would be such a saying, would it not? God says this about Job. Job has all these possessions, would be considered a very rich man. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and when they got together, just in case they were doing something they didn't need to, he would send and offer a sacrifice for them. I mean, he already had that in his mind. He was ready, you know, to sacrifice just in case. Well, there come a day. There come a day, and we look at Job 1 and 6, when the sons of God came to present themselves, and Satan also came. I don't know why Satan ended up there. I don't know. But what we do know is this conversation. See, the Lord said to Satan, "From where did you come?" So Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth and walking back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? That there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil." And again, not only did he say it in verse 1, here Satan is right in front of him, and the Lord says, "Have you considered this man? He is blameless above all other men." And say, well, that is quite a statement. But then Satan, you know how Satan does it, twists it a little bit. So Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and surely he will curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, all that he has is in your power. Only do not lay a hand on his person." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Now notice that. Satan looked at God and accused him. He said, "Does Job worship and honor you for nothing? You've given him everything. Everything. You protected everything that he has. If you take it away, you won't." What'd God say? "Take it away. Just don't kill him. Don't touch him. This time, don't touch him. Take it all away." He took it all away. Everything we mentioned in the first, in verses 2 and 3, gone. It's taken away. He hears this one after another. You want to talk about a bad day? That'd be a really bad day. Everybody you see is telling you lost something very precious. Verse 22, "In all this, Job did not sin nor charge God with wrong." So what happens in chapter 2? When everybody's gathered together, Satan invites himself to the party as well. Notice again, verse 2. "And the Lord said to Satan, 'From where did you come?' Satan answered the Lord and said, 'From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking back and forth on it.' Then the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job? That there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. And still he holds fast his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him without a cause.'" A third time this is said about Job. The second time, straight to Satan's face. He's blameless, he's upright, and he's still holding on. Satan does it again. "Skin for skin is all that a man has will give for his life. Stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Behold, he is in your hand, but spare his life." Go ahead. Let's see what happens. Then it happens. We have verse 9. Now I want you to think about this for a second. Here he's sick, he's hurting, he's got boils. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die. Would you just give it up right now? Why? Why suffer? Just get it over with." No, can't do that. Can't do that. Then he has three friends. Comes in verse 11. Notice what it says. It's about halfway down. Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite, for they had made an appointment together to come and mourn and comfort him. And when they raised their eyes from afar and did not recognize him, they lifted their voices and went. And each one tore his robe and sprinkled dust on his head toward heaven. So they sat down with him on the ground 7 days and 7 nights. And no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that he was his grief was very great. That is, if you've read between chapter 3 and about chapter 42, That was the best thing they did for that man the whole time. Have you read their conversations about Job? They accuse him of great and terrible sins. Robbing his neighbors, robbing the poor, holding things back. See, they accuse him of all this stuff, and he sits there and listens to it over and over and over. I mean, what would you do if your friend just kept walking up and saying, "You're a terrible sinner. You must have been. You've lost everything, even your health. How terrible are you, Job? You just need to repent now." Over and over and over, Job said, "I didn't do anything wrong. I didn't do anything wrong." You know, we see it on this side of that. And you know what? He didn't do anything wrong. He didn't. But he had to endure it. The whole time, he had to endure it. And on top of that, he had to endure his friends who accuse him of terrible things. Now, he indeed gets to see God because he won his day in court. God speaks to him out of a whirlwind, and Job repents because there are things that Job doesn't understand. And Job accused God of leaving him, which God never did. Notice what he says in verse 1, Job 42:1. "Then Job answered the Lord and said, 'I know that you can do everything, and that no purpose of yours can be withheld from you. You ask, who is this who hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Listen, please, and let me speak. You said, I will question you, and you shall answer me. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see you. Therefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes.'" Everything he accused God of, he repents of that. But notice verse 7. "And so it was, after the Lord had spoken these words to Job, that the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, 'My wrath is aroused against you and your two friends, for you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has.'" And he goes on, he tells them to offer a sacrifice, and Job is going to be their priest. Job is going to offer that for them. See, he had to endure all those things all the way to the end. See, that's perseverance. That's the patience of Job. But you got to remember, who was it that was putting him to the big test? Oh, I know. Satan took stuff. I understand that. But how about his wife saying, "Won't you just curse God and die right now?" How about his three friends? "You're terrible, Job. You're an unrighteous man. Or else you wouldn't go through all this stuff." He had to endure all that as well. And keep his conversation with God correct. I mean, that's that whole time he had to stay right with God while he's being accused of something that he wasn't doing. Let's go back to James. When we look at the end, James 5, the first six verses, James is really getting on to the people who defrauded their brethren, that withheld money, that told them they would do one thing and never come through on their promise on purpose. It wasn't like they accidentally didn't pay them or didn't do what they're supposed to. They on purpose was neglected in taking care of their promises. They just didn't do it. So James is telling the other ones to be patient. Be patient with your brethren. Be patient with your brethren. See, ever sat and thought about that for a second? There are times when we got to sit back and just be patient with one another. See, it's an amazing thing. Notice how he puts it. "See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and latter rain." When you think about going out and farming, see, there's a time and a place when Farmville was a big deal. You get on the internet and you plant fake corn, in about 30 minutes you got corn. You can plant tomatoes, in about 15 minutes you got tomatoes. It don't work like that. You plant corn today, 90 days later you might get it. 3 months later, if it's not 120. I mean, that's patient work, isn't it? You sit and you wonder, is it getting watered enough? You may have to dig a ditch to make sure it keeps water. You'll have to fertilize it. You have to take care of it and make sure it grows. It's a long process. You don't start today and get it tomorrow. It doesn't work that way. The real life really doesn't. So Sam, be patient. Be patient. Plant the seed. Continue on. Notice in verse 9. Do not grumble against one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. Who's the judge? The Lord of Sabaoth. The Lord sees all of that. He already knows. He already knows. He's at hand. So what do we got to do? Be patient and persevere. Be patient and persevere. Have you ever sat and thought how many times that Jesus and the rest of the New Testament writers urge unity, urge to be together in things? Why is that? Because we have our own ideas, and sometimes we want to go different places. But if we bear with one another, we can help each other continue on. Notice again, we look in Ephesians in chapter 4. It's that before that great discussion on unity, notice what Paul says. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech or urge you to walk worthy of the calling with which you are called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with longsuffering. It's that being patient. Bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity, of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now when we look at this idea, at the end of verse 2, it tells us something. Bear with one another in love. Be patient with one another in love. Be patient. Persevere with one another in love. It's that drawing to unity. It's that oneness. And Paul says you got to work at it. And we do got to work at it. If we looked back in Matthew 18, there's a question. Peter's the one who asked the question. How many times does my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Seven times, you know. How many times? Up to seven times is what Peter asked. Jesus said 70 times, seven times. Now what Jesus didn't want is just to get a little Rolodex. You remember what those are? I know it's Stone Age. Maybe you grab a phone out and you write it down and I'm afraid to mention a name. I'll name somebody. But just say Ralph, okay? You say Ralph, and today he's sinned. We're going to put a tally mark there. And then something else happens. And I do something, and I mess up once again. And so you get your little Rolodex out, or your palm pile, or wherever you got, and you flip through there. And, let's go ahead. That's another one. And he doesn't say keep tally, because at 491, that guy's really in trouble. That wasn't the point of that whole thing. As many times as we need to be forgiven, we forgive. We don't need to hold a grudge. Why? It's a whole lot better going to heaven together than trying to figure it out by ourselves. See, that's the goal. So we got unity, the patience of Job. Notice, we go back to James. We're going to look at Elijah just for a minute. Notice what he says. Starts in verse 12. But above all, my brethren, do not swear either by heaven or by earth, or with another oath. But let your yes be yes, and your no, lest you fall into judgment. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Is anyone sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Now notice, we have Elijah. But notice something about Elijah. Elijah was a man with a nature just like ours. See, a lot of time we go back and we read the prophets and we almost think they're superhuman. We almost think that they would never do things that we would do today, that everything was always okay with them. But that's not how that worked. See, and just to give an overview of something just to think about, was Elijah on Mount Carmel in 1 Kings in chapter 18. Now you think about that. Elijah on Mount Carmel, and here he is. He's with the prophets of Baal, and he stands up in front of all these men. These 500 men. He's there. He is the lone prophet of God. 500 prophets of Baal. I mean, look over the crowd 10 times more by himself. Who wins that battle? Elijah does. Well, God does. He's the one that sets it on fire. Everybody else is cutting themselves and screaming out to the God, and nothing happens. You'd say that would be such a mountaintop experience, wouldn't it? You're up there, you won the great battle, you led God's people to victory, all the false prophets are now dead. Well, it's smooth sailing from here, all blue skies and rainbows. Mountaintop experience. Have you ever read chapter 19? Jezebel. 500 prophets of Baal, Elijah not fazed. Jezebel, one woman's going to kill him. He loses everything. He runs away. He runs away and leaves his servant somewhere else, and he keeps going until he comes underneath a broom tree and tells God to take me. I'm ready to die. Gather me up and take me to my father's. Wow, that's amazing, isn't it? And then he kind of what we would call falls into a depression. He's not eating. He's wanting to sleep all the time. He's giving up on life. He don't have anywhere to go. Elijah goes through the valley just like we would go through a valley. When we're up here one moment and then we're down here. We'll say, what in the world? How'd I get here? Everything was good. Now I'm scraping pennies just to buy a cheeseburger. How does that work? My life was put together. My life's a mess. See, that's the deal, isn't it? The thing about Elijah is he still followed God even when he was in that valley. Even when things didn't look good, he was still keeping on. See, Peter does stuff like this in Matthew chapter 16. You remember how that works. Who do men say that I am? Well, Elijah or one of the prophets. Well, who do you say that I am? You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. What a powerful statement. Only about three verses later, him looking at Jesus saying, no, Lord, you're not die. Get behind me, Satan. You're mindful of things of earth, not things of heaven. He was way up here, wasn't he? I got it right. He is the Christ. Oh, wait a minute. Jesus said, I'm acting like Satan now. We got to continue on. See, we cannot give up on God because life becomes hard. We cannot. We got to keep going. And you know, if God heard Elijah's prayer and his nature is like ours, he'll hear our prayers as well. He'll hear our prayers too. See, what an amazing thought. What an amazing thought. See, when we look at the end of this book, there are three people that really stick out. The Lord of Sabaoth, the Lord of Hosts, the one who hears us and sees us and knows us. Now, I know as we look in this passage, he sees us as far as the bad things we're doing and we're trying to hide. But you know what? He also sees the good things that we're doing. And he remembers those things. He sees them to remember them. He knows the good things that we're doing in his name. He doesn't forget that from day to day. He remembers that. Then we have Job, who through even with the tough times with his friends, persevered all the way through that. All the way through everything that was going on in his life. And he was rewarded at the end. We also got to have that same perseverance. There are going to be times that we got to sit down and say, I got to do what God says. And there are times we look and say, I love you. Let's go together. Let's go together. Elijah's a man like with a nature like ours, and God heard him. He heard him in a very powerful way on multiple occasions. And he'll hear you too. He'll hear you too. As we close the lesson, I want to close with the same thought James leaves in verse 19. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. See, what James said there was it's not too late. Even though these things were happening and these things were indicative of what was going on or was an indication of how they lived life, it wasn't too late. They could go home and they could be welcomed again. See, isn't that a beautiful thought? That you're never too far away. You don't ever drift so far away that you can't come home. Today, where are you? Are you on your way home? Or are you floating around over here somewhere? Why don't we just come home? As we think about our lives, if you're living the way God wants you to live, and you're persevering, you're pushing through, and you're holding that faith just like Job and Elijah, continue on. The fight is long, the fight is tough. Continue living it. But if something happened and the world got in your way, come back. Come back. Don't be away any longer. There's no need to be out there. Out there is danger. With him is safety. If you're subject to the invitation, come as we sing this song.